Okay, how about if we open in a word of prayer? Thank you, George. Father, thank you so much for all of the blessings and all of the little nuggets that we can sometimes discover in your word. And we just pray that study tonight about the Dew of Hermon will be enriching and blessing, and that your word will work in us as it was intended. And we love you so very much. In Christ's name, amen. Real quick, for the folks on YouTube, I do get a couple of emails a week about the 95 Theses Against Dispensationalism, and yes, I will get back to that. And also, if for those on Facebook, if you have found that you have enjoyed a lot of the wonderful messages, especially by Pastor Fred and Pastor Hal, and you would feel so inclined, we do have a link to the donate page on our website, which would always be greatly appreciated. And we do have a big announcement. We're going to have a Fellowship Bible Church conference last weekend in September. And it'll be awesome. It's going to take place over the weekend. We'll live stream it. We've already got a couple of speakers lined up, and the topic's going to be the attributes of God. And so every speaker is going to have a different attribute to talk about. So by the time it's over, you know, hopefully every man will get a good, clear picture of so many aspects of God, and every man will have praise of God. So turn, if you would, to Psalms chapter 133, pretty please. It's a Fellowship Bible Church conference for everybody, and details to come. Yes, especially women. At least that's important, too. You're welcome. I want to start by talking about, there's a story told by a grace believer that I always loved. And because I love you. There's a story told by a grace believer that I love, in which, and this goes back a little bit, and he talks about this time that he walked across the Golden Gate Bridge. And I'll just quote his words, and he said, I was standing in the middle of the Golden Gate Bridge admiring the view when another man walked up alongside of me, and I heard him say quietly, "What an awesome God." I turned to him and said, "Are you a Christian?" And he said, "Yes, I am a Christian." And I said, "So am I," and we shook hands. And I said, "Are you a liberal or a fundamental Christian?" He said, "I am a fundamental Christian." And I said, "So am I." And we smiled at each other. And I said, "Are you a covenant or a dispensational fundamental Christian?" And he said, "I am a dispensational fundamental Christian." And I said, "So am I." And we slapped each other on the back. And I said, "Are you an early Acts, mid Acts, or late Acts dispensational fundamental Christian?" And he said, "I am a mid Acts dispensational fundamental Christian." And I said, "So am I." And so we agreed to exchange Christmas cards every year. And I said, "Are you a pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib, mid-Acts dispensational fundamental Christian?" And he said, "I am a pre-trib, mid-Acts dispensational fundamental Christian." I said, "So am I," and we decided to exchange kids for the summer. And I said, "Are you a 12-in or 12-out, pre-trib, mid-Acts, dispensational, fundamental Christian?" And he said, "I am a 12-out, pre-trib, mid-Acts, dispensational, fundamental Christian." And I said, "So am I," and we made vacation plans together. So I said, "So on reconciliation, are you a Christ paid for all sins, or are you a Christ paid for some sins, 12-out, pre-trib, mid-Acts, dispensational, fundamental Christian?" And he said, "I am a Christ paid for all sins, 12-out, pre-trib, mid-Acts, dispensational, fundamental Christian." And I said, "You heretic," and I pushed him off the bridge. That's it. Yeah. Yeah, so So the topic tonight is about unity and and grace. Unity. Actually, it is about unity and grace. And Psalms 133 is about that very thing. And I had actually discovered this article written by Charles Henry McIntosh called The Dew of Hermon. And I was like, what is that? And I loved it. I thought it was awesome. And then I noticed that a whole bunch of other dispensationalists on the zip drives also really, really loved Psalms 133 and wrote articles about it. I mean, even Arno Gabelein, he said he loved this psalm, and he said it had the fragrance of a lovely rose. So let's read together, if you would, Psalms 133. A song of degrees of David. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. It really is a beautiful psalm, and the last couple of weeks I looked at it, I've just really fallen in love with everything about this. And there are two ways of looking at this beautiful psalm. One is that this psalm is about the unity that was taking place at the time it was written, which is why David writes, "Behold," you could see it. And it's thought that this was written shortly after the conflict between David and Saul, and it was the time when all of the 12 tribes of Israel had unified together in accepting David as their king, and so now that the situation with the Ark of the Covenant was fixed and it was actually resting in the temple in Jerusalem, David took this opportunity to emphasize unity, the importance, the beauty, the goodness of it. And now that the ark is back, they can all live in a unified love. And yet, in this verse, it also looks ahead to the future state of love and unity that Israel will experience during the thousand-year reign of Christ. And it's brilliant to me how these three verses have so much depth to them. And did you notice in verse 1 the exclamation point? Not very often you see those in Scripture, especially in David, in the Psalms. And I did a search. Do you know how many exclamation points there are in the Bible? I actually did a search on the little My Sword program and counted them all up. You have any guesses? 310 exclamation points, at least by my count. If you can imagine that, I never thought there'd be so many. Do you know how many exclamation points Paul has? Well, it should be like, you know, what, four or five times more than what it is, because those God forbid should have an exclamation point. But Paul had 6 exclamation points, and David has 29 exclamation points. And the point here is the emphasis on unity. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And he's inviting the reader to behold and meditate upon the beauty of unity amongst God's people. Behold how these are not simply brethren in the flesh, but in the spirit. Behold the variety of thought, but the unity of heart. Behold the mutual esteem, the affection, and the grace of the brethren toward each other. Behold the unity that can only come from love. Behold all the qualities of unity, the giving up of oneself, the humble, peaceful spirit, the commitment to the word and will of God, and the spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ working through his people. Behold the source of that unity, which is God himself, who is the God of peace. And you behold how unity brings joy not only to those living in peace, but also to God himself. And behold and meditate upon the enriching depth of so much sweetness that comes from a spirit of unity amongst his people. Behold, he shows us, what an exemplary, divine, holy, righteous attribute it is to seek peace. And these principles of peace, of seeking peace, is a timeless across all dispensations. Up on the PowerPoint, we've got Psalms 122:6. Pray for the peace of Israel, they shall prosper that love thee. Peace be within thy walls and prosperity within thy palaces. For my brethren and companions in sake, I will now say, peace be within thee. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Psalm 34:14, depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Proverbs 12:20, deceit is in the heart of them that imagine evil, but to the counselors of peace is joy. Proverbs 16:7, when a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. Proverbs 17:1, better is a dry morsel and quietness therewith than a house full of sacrifices with strife. Proverbs 23, it is an honor for a man to cease from strife, but every fool will be meddling. And in the kingdom, blessed, one of the Beatitudes, Matthew 5:9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Paul himself, in Romans 12:18, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Romans 14:19, let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another. 1 Corinthians 14:33, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. 2 Corinthians 13:11, finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect, be of good comfort, be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. Hebrews 12:14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. James 3:16-18, for where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. 1 Peter 3:10, for he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips, that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. And in verse 2, we have a reference, which I loved, to Aaron, who was anointed with that precious oil. That story with Moses anointing Aaron with that holy oil is in Exodus 28 and 29. But I thought I just might share the section here in Leviticus 8, 9 through 12, in which Moses actually poured the oil on Aaron to anoint him as the high priest of Israel. And it says, and he put the meter, which is a turban, upon his head. Also upon the meter, even upon his forefront, did he put the golden plate, the holy crown, as the Lord commanded Moses. And Moses took the anointing oil and anointed the tabernacle and all that was therein and sanctified them. And he sprinkled thereof upon the altar 7 times and anointed the altar and all his vessels, both the laver and his foot, to sanctify them. And he poured of the anointing oil upon Aaron's head and anointed him to sanctify him. And in this verse 2 of Psalms 133, talks about how precious it is, like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard. And according to Jewish tradition, the 2 drops of the oil remain forever hanging on Aaron's beard like 2 pearls as emblems of atonement and peace. And did you notice that the oil did not stay on his head, but it flowed all the way down to his beard, all the way down his body to the skirts of his garments? He was fully drenched in the holy oil. And I'm sure there were probably parts of his body that did not want to get wet. Whether it wanted to or not, every part was thoroughly drenched by the oil. And ultimately, I'm sure they were thankful for it. But see, this is an example, I think, of David looking to the past to illustrate the present blessings they were experiencing while also looking to the future. And you consider the what happened at Pentecost, the flowing down of the flowing down of the anointing oil is like the outpouring of the Spirit from God the Father in the Lord's name to the believers at Pentecost, and how the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and one soul. And I'm sure that's a moment, if David was there, it would have absolutely taken his breath away, more so than what he was seeing at the time he wrote the psalm. And he would have said, as he said here, "Behold, behold the unity to the glory of God." And that was only a taste of the unity that was to come for the nation of Israel and the kingdom. But then you consider that today, in the age of grace, the Holy Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit, the very character of Christ himself flows down from the head to all the members of the body. We are all drenched equally, and we may be nothing more than a toe of his foot, but we are given the fullness of him as much as any other parts of the body, and our hearts are full. Ephesians 1:23, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Like what John said, of his fullness have we all received, grace for grace. And you consider too that we are even more, the program for us today is even more perfect through the baptism of the Spirit than what Aaron had experienced with the anointing of the holy oil. And Charles Henry McIntosh had said that those who believe on him and are washed by his precious blood are sharers of his Spirit. The Spirit flows from the head to every member of his body. We are baptized by the same Spirit into one body. This produces unity, the unity of the Spirit, a spiritual unity. If it will be true of redeemed Israel that they dwell together as brethren in unity, how much more should this be true among the members of the body of Christ? And then we get to verse 3, finally, the Dew of Hermon. And in Hebrew, it's like called Kirman, Mane, which is really weird. I don't know if I should say Hermon or Hermon. Hermon sounds rather, got a nice flair to it. So, actually, I've got a map here of the on the PowerPoint of the of where it's located, and you can see Israel in the lower left, Syria on the right, and Lebanon in the north there, and Mount Hermon has the lucky good fortune of being on the border of all three, of Israel, Syria, and Lebanon, and it's not exactly a place where you'd want to get lost. It's actually, Mount Hermon is actually a cluster of mountains, and it's got three distinct summits. All about the same height, which I read that and I was like, wow, I can't help but wonder if that was divinely intended for the sake of this illustration. And you can see in the red, that kind of flows down south to a point on the border of Jordan there. The southern slopes of Mount Hermon extends to the Israeli-occupied portion of the Golan Heights, and Israel has a ski resort there, and it's actually pretty cool. Here's a picture of the peak of Mount Hermon, which is, I think, 9,232 feet above sea level. It's the highest point on the border between Lebanon and Syria. That doesn't look bad. And on the top of the peak of Mount Hermon is the highest permanently manned UN position in the world, which is called Hermon Hotel, which is pretty funny. And here you can see a lot of the Jurassic limestone, and it's broken by faults and solution channels to form what they call a karst topography, which is a landscape formed from the dissolution of soluble rocks, such as limestone, dolomite, and gypsum. Beautiful, I thought. And here, I love this photo. Mount Hermon here you can see a lot of that Jurassic limestone going on. And here you got the river. And it has a seasonal winter and spring snowfalls, which covers all three of its peaks for most of the year. And then melt water from the snow-covered caps seeps into the rock channels and pours, and it feeds into springs at the base of the mountain, which form streams and rivers, and they all merge to become the Jordan River. This is on the Lebanon side. Lebanon side has a whole bunch of ancient Roman temples that are abandoned, which is really beautiful. I thought that was gorgeous. Here's another one I thought really liked in the wintertime. And this picture here is a good illustration of how the mountain is, why Israel dubs it the eyes of the nation, because it gives such a great deep view into Syria. Here's a picture of it on a cap. Here's the ski resort. Here's some artwork of the mountain over the years. These other photos here, I threw that in here. These were pictures of the Roman ruins that are on the Lebanon side of the mountain, which I thought were pretty cool. It's just a neat place altogether. But back to the verse, verse 3, as the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountain of Zion. And I couldn't help but notice that there was a lot of debate about the dew amongst the non-dispensational commentaries, which was kind of hilarious to me. They all said the same thing. A lot of that I got off the Bible Hub website. But they basically said that the verse is translated wrong, and it's not possible because the dew, if you remember from the map, Jerusalem is way south. And the dew from the mountain, it would mean that the dew would have to travel about 100 miles in order to get to Jerusalem, and it's not possible, doesn't happen. So the verse is translated incorrectly. It shouldn't say, as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion. It should be like, because this is just symbolism and allegory. And I just shook my head. You almost want to say, oh, ye of little faith. And I would suggest that the verse is translated correctly because the dew was literally coming down from Mount Hermon, moving across the whole 100 miles, all the way to Jerusalem at the time that the verse was written. And it was, I would suggest, a part of that physical blessing God was giving as part of the if-then principle. And in that particular time when David wrote the Psalms 133, they were obeying his words, they were in beautiful unity, and God was blessing them with literally a physical blessing from the dew of Hermon that actually came down from the mountain and moved across Israel and blessed the land of Jerusalem, the hills and the humble valleys of Jerusalem. And you can't help but, I mean, surely you believe that manna came down from heaven when the Jews were in the wilderness, right? So why should it be any more difficult to believe that dew could come down from Mount Hermon and travel 100 miles to Israel? It was interesting to me. First thing the non-dispensationalists do is question the verse, and the first thing the dispensationalists do, they don't even think about questioning the verse, and they accept it at face value for what it says. This is just another reason why I love the dispensational commentaries so much more. So, the dew in verse 3 is likened to brotherly love, and the dew descending from Hermon's snowy top brought the dry, parched hills and mountains of Zion, refreshment and blessing, just as the unity of the Spirit also brought the weary souls of Israel refreshing power and blessing. The physical blessing of the dew came down from the heights of the biggest mountain in all of Canaan, just as all the spiritual blessings to their souls came from God Himself. It's a great big type of God. And it was fascinating to me, thinking about verse 3, all the similarities and the distinctions between their program and ours in relation to this illustration with the dew from Hermon. In Israel's case, the blessings from God was the result of the unity, which were the Hebrews obeying His word. But in the age of grace, the unity is the result of the blessings we've already been given in Christ. Dwight L. Moody said, a great many people are trying to make peace, but that has already been done. God has not left it for us to do. All we have to do is to enter into it. And Arno Gabelein had written in his article on this that a traveler of long ago wrote, "Here I sat at the foot of Hermon and understood how the dew drops which rose from its forest-mantled heights and out of their ravines filled the whole year with snow, after the sun's rays have attenuated them and moistened the atmosphere with them, descend at evening time as heavy dew upon the lower mountains." And it occurred to me, just as it occurred to a lot of these dispensationalists who wrote about it, that the similarity between this illustration in Psalms 133 and us today is that the degree of Israel's blessing and the degree of our success in our walk are both in direct proportion to how close we are to the mountain. And for us, to bring ourselves closer to the mountain in our spiritual walk is determined by how much we've come to accept what He's already done for us and how well we have endeavored in our lives to know Christ intimately, all that He is. The more we become like Him, the closer we are to the mountain. To do that, we must live close to Christ and be occupied with Him so that His virtues may shine in us and we reflect His blessed image. We must not only embrace our identification with His all-sufficient payment on the cross, but also embrace the new man, no longer looking up at the Lord through the eyes of the old man, but we look upon ourselves as new creatures, complete in Him, already seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We appropriate the fruits of the Spirit, and we, as Hal said, align our earthly walk with our heavenly identity. Then we'll come to truly recognize that we were never apart from the mountain, but we were always, from the moment we were saved, a part of the mountain, bone of His bone and flesh of His flesh. And blessings to others today are no longer from the mountain directly in a physical sense, but in a spiritual sense, the blessings are through His Word and through us, with His grace descending upon our souls like the drenching of the holy oil upon Aaron or the refreshing dew from the snowy tops of Hermon across all the hills and humble valleys of Zion. And this is, that wasn't a message that was meant to be unity at all costs. We're to defend the truth, fight the good fight, and protect believers from those who would rob us of our liberties in Christ. But as grace believers, we're also again and again called by the Apostle Paul to unity as much as possible. And on the PowerPoint, we've got Romans 12:16. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Romans 14:19. Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another. Romans 15:5. Now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in 1 Corinthians 1:10, we have, Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. 2 Corinthians 13:11, Finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect, be of good comfort, be of one mind. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. Ephesians 4:1, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with longsuffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Philippians 1:27, Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Philippians 2:2, Fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. And nevertheless, whereto for? Philippians 3:16, We have already attained. Let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. And Charles Henry McIntosh, in his article that I just love so much, he said, It is one thing to talk about unity and another thing altogether to dwell in it. We may profess to hold the unity of the body and the unity of the spirit, most precious and glorious truth, surely, and all the while actually be full of selfish strife, party spirit, and sectarian feelings, all of which are entirely destructive to practical unity. If brethren are to dwell together in unity, they must be receiving the anointment from the head, the refreshing showers from the true Hermon. They must live in the very presence of Christ so that all their rough edges may be rounded out, all their selfishness judged and subdued, all their own peculiar notions set aside, all their strife flung to the winds. There will be largeness of heart, breadth of mind, and depth of sympathy. Thus we shall learn to bear and forbear. It will not then be us loving only those who think like us. It will be us loving all who love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Where did Paul get the grace to enable him to be ready to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrifice of his brethren? What was it that made Timothy care for other people? What led Epaphroditus to put his life in his hand to supply his brethren's lack? What is the one grand answer to all these questions? Simply this: these beloved servants of Christ drank so deeply into his spirit, they dwelt so near the mountain, the man in glory, that the fragrant ointment and the refreshing dew fell upon their souls abundantly and made them channels of blessings to others. And the blessed head loves all the members of his body. And if we are drinking into his spirit, if we are learning from him, we shall love all likewise. It is Christ and not self. And this is what we want if we are to dwell together in unity. Then what joy to be enabled in any little measure to refresh the heart of God. He delights to see his children walking in love. It is he who says, "Behold, how good, how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And surely this ought to stir our hearts to seek in every possible way to promote this lovely unity. It should lead us to sink self and all its belongings, to surrender everything that might tend in any measure to alienate our hearts from Christ or from one another. The Holy Spirit exhorts us to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. It is the unity of the Spirit, not the unity of the body, we are to keep in the bond, uniting bond of peace. This will cost us something. The word endeavoring shows that it cannot be done without effort and even sacrifice, but the one who so graciously exhorts us to his service will ever supply us the needed grace. The ointment and the dew will flow down from him in refreshing power, knitting our hearts together in holy love and enabling us to deny ourselves and surrender everything which might tend to hinder that true unity which we are imperatively called to maintain. And
134, a song of degrees.
Stop. And this is live too, I think. It won't stop. No, actually I'm done. I 7 pages. I didn't think I always thought it was going to go over, but I ended short. And I got your email on the Jurassic Limestone. Thank you, Fred. Does anybody have any thoughts on this? This is going on the blooper reel, huh? Yeah. Does anybody have any thoughts? Any feedback about? Yes, sir. Butch. Ah, beautiful.
They're really together.
Beautiful, beautiful. Butch pointed out that in the Hebrew, the unity is even together, which is even more together than just being together. Did I say that right? Yes. Beautiful. I love that. Even together, yes. Anybody else have any thoughts before I close early with my talking tablet? All right, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for just letting us consider this wonderful, beautiful psalm, which we love. And the imagery and the thoughts of unity are so precious. And frankly, we just pray for unity amongst not only our church, but the grace movement abroad. And we love you so very dearly. And just pray that we continue to stay focused on you throughout the rest of the week. In Christ's name, amen.